Hello students, so today we will see process synchronization, which comes in module 2. Today I will be discussing about the introduction to process synchronization and the critical section problem. Coming to what critical section problem is, see, you have learned of cooperating processes, right? Cooperating processes here. So cooperating processes are nothing but processes which share some resources. Okay, so let's consider there are two processes, P1 and P2. Okay, so shared resources can be in the form of memory, it can be in the form of files, or it can be in the form of variables. That is, maybe process P1 and P2 share some variables that are in common. Okay, so cooperating processes are processes which share the resources. Now, these two processes will concurrently, let's say the shared resource is a variable over here, okay? So these two processes will be concurrently accessing this variable, which will result in a modification of this variable, right? So what happens is these shared variables or shared resources will be placed in a section of program called as critical section, okay? So in a program, you can divide a program into critical section and remainder section. So in critical section, in critical section, we will have all the resources that are common to the processes, cooperating processes. So what happens is, if P1 and P2 have some shared variable V, and then both try to modify V, the value of V will be different, okay? And that should not happen in critical section. Critical section is a very important section where modifications of some variables which are being shared by any processes should not be changed or should not have two different values, okay? So that is a problem what happens in critical section, and this is called as critical section problem. So concurrent access to shared data may result in data inconsistency. That is what I said. So this variable can have two different values, two different values, one with respect to P1 and one with respect to P2. So this results in inconsistency. So we have to use critical section in such a way that the processes all are synchronized and the variable data is also not inconsistent. Okay, so maintaining data consistencies require mechanism to ensure the orderly execution of cooperating processes. Here, now we'll take an example. We'll go to the other slide. Okay, now there is a concept called as race condition here. So before I talk about race condition, we will just take an example of producer and consumer problem. You know producer and consumer problem. So producer produces and consumer has to consume it. So this code is with respect to producer, and this code is with respect to the consumer. So I will not go deep into the code, but let's see that count plus plus means the producer is producing, and count minus minus means the consumer is consuming. So this we can consider as a critical section, because here we have a variable count which is used by both the processes. So producer is also a process, consumer is also a process. So here we have two processes which have a shared variable count, and this particular, so this is a critical section of producer code, and this is the critical section of consumer code, and their critical sections have a shared variable which is count. Now if you go through this, here it says that, so let's say producer executes. Okay, initially we will assume that the count of the variable is 5. That is, the value assigned to count is initially 5. So let's say producer executes. So when producer executes, this 5 is given to register 1. So register 1 has 5 here. Okay, so second time, at the second instance, the producer again executes. Okay, so in that case, the second line executes. So 5 plus 1 is 6. So register 1 has 6 in it. In the third instant, we allow the consumer process to execute. So when consumer process executes, initially the value is 5 only, right? So concurrently, let us assume that they are concurrently executing. So count is still 5 for consumer. So 5 is given to register 2. Again, we allow the consumer to process. Okay, so consumer process. So what happens is 5 minus 1 becomes 4. So if you think these two processes are concurrently executing, then you will find that in a processor, that is producer process, the count variable is equated to 6, and in the consumer process, the count is equated to 4. That means you have two different values to the variable count. This happened because the two processes were executing concurrently. So you had an inconsistency in the variable count. This should not happen in critical section. Okay. So we can make only one process execute in the critical section at one point of time, not allowing both to execute simultaneously. So this is one solution we can give. So this particular case where you have inconsistencies in the shared resources, that is called as race condition. So race condition is nothing but you get different values for the shared variables, because this totally depends on the order of execution. So this inconsistency is called as race condition. Okay. Let me move on to the next slide. Okay, now here, so as I said, we need to make the processes synchronized such that both don't concurrently execute in their critical section. Okay, that is to avoid inconsistencies. So here we can avoid this kind of problem by having an entry section and an exit section. That is, if a process wants to execute its critical section, then it has to obtain permission to enter the critical section. So basically, this entry section will be a code that a process has to execute, and only then it will be allowed into critical section. Similarly, if a process has completed its execution, then if it wants to exit, then it has to execute the exit section code. Okay. Yeah. So we have so many solutions to this critical section problem, that is with respect to entry section and exit section. So in every solution you see, there will be different codes written for entry section and exit section. You can write your own codes for entry section and exit section such that only one process will be in the critical section at a point of time. Okay, so entry section is the code that will enable a process to enter into critical section, and exit section is a code that will enable the process to exit the section. Remainder section is the one that is not a critical section. Okay. Yeah. So you have many solutions to this. You have solutions through semaphores. You have solutions through monitors. Okay. Monitors, all that you will see in the later on slides. Let's move on to the next slide. Okay. Now, as I said, there are many solutions to overcome the critical section problem. You can frame your own solutions, but we have already some solutions for critical section problem, which is through semaphores, monitors, which you will see in the later on slides. Okay. So now, if at all you are planning to build any solution for this critical section problem, then you should always satisfy these three conditions, which is mutual exclusion, progress, and bounding weighting. Let's move to mutual exclusion. So what is mutual exclusion? So mutual exclusion is nothing but, in simple terms, let's say there is two process P1 and P2, and we have a critical section. So exclusion says that if P1 is already in critical section, then P2 should not be allowed into critical section, or vice versa. If P2 is in critical section, then P1 should not be allowed into critical section. That is, at a time, only one process can be executing in the critical section. This is what it says. If the process PI is executing in its critical section, then no other process can be executing in their critical sections. Okay, that is mutual exclusion. Yeah. Now coming to progress. In progress, what we say is, let's say again we have two processes P1 and P2, and there is a critical section, and one wishes to enter into critical section. So when one wishes to enter into critical section, two should not preempt its wish. Okay, that is two should not interfere in the wish of one. That is, if one wants to enter into critical section, that is what we are saying is the condition for one to enter critical section is critical section has to be empty. So if critical section is empty and one wishes to enter into critical section, then no other process should disallow the entry of process one into the critical section. That is what it says. So that is, you have to let the processes, whichever processes wishes to enter, only one at a time. So whichever process wishes to enter the critical section, if the critical section is empty, then that process should be let to enter. Okay. So if no process is executing, that means if critical section is empty and there exist some processes that wish to enter the critical section, then the selection of the process that will enter the critical section cannot be postponed. That is, two cannot postpone the wish of one. So one can enter. That is, yeah. So other processes cannot preempt the wish of P1. Okay. Now coming to the third one, bounded waiting. What is bounded waiting? Coming to the third one, let me say again, third one. Let's say you have one and two again, and there is a critical section. Let's say one has got a chance to enter into critical section. So after it executes, so how does it enter a critical section? One has to execute entry code. After it successfully executes entry code, then it can enter into critical section. And after it is done with the modifications, it can now, it should now perform exit section code. Okay. And then again, if it wishes to go back, yes, it can again go back to the critical section. Yes. Okay, once again it enters into critical section. Again, after it comes out, it can go again to critical section. But if it happens so that only one gets to enter the critical section and two never gets a chance to enter critical section, then this is not fair. No, one cannot always be in critical section. Yes, it can be either twice, thrice, four times, but not in a manner that it not at all allows process two to be in critical section, right? So every process should have a chance to be in their critical section. Right, so that is called as bounded waiting. Two cannot go into indefinite waiting. There should be some bounded waiting. That is, there should be some count. For example, two can enter after one can finish executing twice or thrice in the critical section. So this is a bounded waiting. That is, a bound must exist on the number of times that other processes are allowed to enter their critical section after a process has made a request to enter its critical section. For example, there should be number of times that one can enter when two has made a wish to enter the critical section. So one can only be allowed to execute in critical section for some amount of time, and then two should be allowed to enter into critical section. Okay, so this is what is three requirements that you have to keep in mind whenever we try to write a solution for critical section problem. So if your solution does not satisfy any one of these conditions, then it is not a valid one. It cannot be a critical section solution. So it has to satisfy these three conditions. So in the next video, we will see that we'll see a number of solutions for this critical section problem. Thank you, guys.